Hallelujah. Faith that can be seen. The evidence of your faith should be seen by everyone you encounter in your life. But the faith we're going to talk about today is a whole lot different than when he started out this week. Amen?
Amen.
If you have your Bibles, turn to Galatians, the 5th chapter, verses, we're going to read 4 to 6. It's 1 to 6. Your faith is not in action because you don't have the source of its power living through you. I think I got everybody's attention on that, didn't I? There's a power source to faith. This isn't just you believing. There's a power source. And there's only one power source that moves mountains. There's only one. There is no other. You can speak to a mountain all day long. It's not going to go anywhere. If you don't have the power source that activates faith. This is where everything changed yesterday morning when I got up early and started redoing this whole message. Thank you, Jesus. Verses 4 to 6, Galatians 5. You have become estranged from Christ. You who attempt to be justified by the law. You have fallen from grace. For we through the Spirit eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything, but faith working through love. 1 John 4:8, God is love. You choose that. It's a choice to make in your life through love. All these people, you're going to hear more, oh, I got faith for this, I got faith for that. No, that's faith for things. Man-made faith, I'm going to have more faith to do this. No, you got as much faith as you were ever going to get in your whole life the day you got born again. You're not going to get any more faith than that because you got His faith put in you. He didn't get your own. That's not even yours. He put it in you by His Spirit. But it's motivated by the power of His love when He said it is finished, He died, He rose again. Now the Holy Spirit comes to impart you with all that God is, and the whole center of His existence is love. Everything is done by love. 1 Corinthians, the love chapter. You should never be envious or jealous or anything else towards other Christians that get used, because maybe you're not being used because you don't have the power of the love that they're walking in. You might have unforgiveness. You might have bitterness. We're going to get to that in a bit. Everybody wants faith-moving power. You already have it. But there's a power source. If we go out and disconnect everybody's batteries in their cars out here, and we go to leave, we're all going to be standing in the parking lot. Because there's no power to turn the engine over, is there? Your engine is based on love power. How much does the Father truly love you? He showed it by sending love to the cross. The love of the Father's heart was put there for all of us. Amen?
Amen.
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 You choose it. It's not... I wish I could say there's another way around it, but when Paul says that, the verse before, you attempt to be justified by the law. Anybody that's in works of the flesh is not walking in love. You know why? You're trying to earn love from God. You can't. You can't earn from Him. You can earn absolutely nowhere in the New Testament, in the covenant, does it say you're going to earn anything from God. Ever. You receive from God, but the number one thing you need to receive is the power of His love to see yourself as forgiven, redeemed, sanctified, washed in the blood of Jesus. Then you start to see how much your love, and then the love that was put into you the day you got saved can start coming back out. We are a conduit for God's love, not for things. Things come with the blessing. Remember something, your whole life has to change the way your whole, the whole objection of your affections, everything that you could object, you know, that we got to have.
Desire.
This world teaches you got to have something to show you have faith. You know how many faith preachers of old used to say the bigger the house, the more faith you got? That's the biggest lie from Satan there is on planet Earth. It's the biggest deception. Just because somebody has a big house doesn't mean they have more faith than you do.
Look at the size of God's house.
Yeah. His has no ending.
He has better credit.
Yeah.
That's it.
But you see, if your heart is focused on the natural world, the love of God, it says, isn't even, you're an enemy of God even. You want to go even further than that. It says, if you have the lust of the eyes, the lust of the world, the lust of the flesh, you're not a friend of God. You don't even have the love of God in you. You can't, because now your heart is impassioned for things that make you think like you're important, and that's going to make you a better person or something. People are going to look at you because, man, I had faith for this, I had faith for that, I had faith for this, I had faith. If it has anything to do with material faith, then you've missed it. Because the material things you need to glorify God, He's going to give you, because before the world began, He already knew what He was going to give you. Problem is, they're all sitting on a shelf in heaven. We just don't know how to call them forth. Amen?
Amen.
I better adjust that a bit before I knock everybody out of the door here today. Because I'm about to get fired up. Just saying.
You're already fired up.
What do you mean? No. I'm not fired up yet. I'm not fired up yet. But I can feel it coming. When my head starts burning here, get ready, because it's already burning. If you have your Bible, turn to Matthew 6. It's so important that we see humanity the way God does. Even though they're stuck in darkness and sin, these people rioting in the streets, they believed lies for so long, they have such an entitlement mentality that came from our government itself, from college professors themselves. It's amazing how I listened to college kids that they interviewed this past weekend that are rioting. These kids are 18, 19, 20, 21, some in their mid-20s, maybe out of school. The stuff I heard came out of their mouth, I just couldn't believe what I was hearing. I have no idea how they're going to function when mommy and daddy kicks them out the door and they can't afford to feed them anymore. I don't know how they're going to make it. They don't know what bleeding on the hands is. They don't know what digging a ditch is. They don't know what chopping down trees are. They don't know what mixing concrete is. They don't know how to cook outside. They couldn't go survive in the woods. I can. I got stuff at home. I can go live in the mountains and not come back for quite a long time. I'll do just fine. But let me tell you something. I've heard things that the violence is part of it. They're just angry because God's convicted everybody. But I saw an entire lost generation out there of kids that have no survival instinct whatsoever. They don't know how to walk and chew gum at the same time. And this government and our colleges have done it. Rebuke them all in the name of Jesus. We pray we have godly teachers in our colleges again. They have safe zones. You've offended me. No, they offend Jesus every day with their ungodliness, which they've accepted as normal. Start praying for the youth of this country that are in our campuses. My God, they are lost souls. I couldn't even believe what I was hearing. I'm going, how do they think like that, Father? How can these words come out of one of them? Made them think they deserve anything in life. We are barely saved. They're lost completely. That's why the revival that's going to come out of the change in the awakening of America. We have a man of God as president. His wife is already talking with the Israel Prime Minister's wife how we're going to have great relations. Because if you check Donald Trump's family, there's Jewish people in his family. Okay? So, we are already so one with Israel. That is the best part of this whole election. Because when you're united and you stand with his children Israel, you will be blessed beyond measure. You watch Abraham's blessings come to the house of God now. Amen? Oh, it's going to change today. That's why this ministry has blessed Israel from the day we've opened and will bless it till the day we go home. Amen?
Amen.
You're not going home yet.
Thank you, Jesus.
Heaven-minded is good, but don't let it interrupt your walk here. That's already a finished product, amen?
Amen.
I've been there. It's done already. He's not building it. It's built. Oh, and he'll be talking about heaven. We'll change the whole sermon. Matthew 6, verses 8 to 15. Therefore, do not be like them, for your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask Him. In this manner, therefore, pray. Our Father, you all know this, in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors, and do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive yours. This is not an option, folks. Forgiveness is not up for discussion. It is mandatory for your journey here on this earth. Unforgiveness is the root of bitterness, which is the cause of probably 90% of the sickness in America and around the world. If you have unforgiveness in your heart, your body's going to react to it. I can tell you right now. You're not going to have unspeakable joy. You're not going to have unspeakable peace that will guard your heart and mind if you have aught against anybody. And don't say God doesn't understand what happened to me and what they did to me. Yeah, he does. He was standing right there. Or it would have been worse. He loved you before you were saved.
Amen.
Look how quiet you are. He loved you before you got washed in his blood and sealed with his spirit. Amen?
Amen.
And then we should be smiling now. We should be rejoicing in this new day that he's blessed us with. Hallelujah.
Amen.
When he says deliver us from the evil one in that prayer, guess what? He already has. When he says give us this daily bread, he already has. He's Jehovah Jireh, your provider. He'll provide all of your need according to his riches and glory found in Christ Jesus. He will. See, that prayer already has been answered. He's already answered that prayer for you. He's already destroyed Satan and disarmed him, rendered him powerless. He says, I'm going to feed you because you don't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. So you're already going to have your needs met. Don't worry about your needs. Don't worry. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. You should never have a day of want. Never. Because it's already answered. It's in the Word. I know what you need before you ask me.
Hallelujah.
I already know what you're going to eat today. He already knows if I get to mom's today what I'm going to order. You should do it every Sunday. They don't even ask anymore. Same, yeah, okay. Oh, it's just my little treat every Sunday. Okay, so he knows already. He already knows every need you have. Before he formed you in your mother's womb, before he said in the beginning. We said it Friday night. Your needs are already met, folks. Stop worrying about needs. Stop worrying about provision. Stop worrying about how you're going to pay for your bills and stuff. If you're walking truly as a loved child of God, and you're walking in the power of love, you'll never doubt his promises that are yes and amen. You'll receive them. You won't be like Paul said, you've walked out from under grace. Now you're trying to earn something from God, like you're trying to deserve something. Look all I've done for the Lord. Who don't say that? You probably all did. I did a few times when I was young and learning. And I was corrected, rightfully so. You really want what you deserve? Never mind, this conversation's over quick. You see what I'm saying? So you learn to kind of laugh at yourself. Because he's a father not like anything here on this earth. His love is unconditional. He can't deny himself. He says, I love you no matter what.
Amen.
The whole thing of the prodigal son is perfect. Because everybody wanders somewhere in the journey with Jesus. You lose that first love. Everybody does it. They say they didn't. They're lying. I don't care what you tell me. Because sometimes life gets to you and you start questioning why you're here. And what God's all about, and is this really you? And you start second-guessing yourself. But if you're walking in that you're loved, and you're forgiven, and you're redeemed, and you're set aside, and you're chosen, and you're eternally set free, then you'll start seeing yourself as a love child. And not, what do I got to do to get this? I need to learn to just bow my head and say, thank you that you love me. Why, I was yet a sinner. You died for me. You loved me before you even created me. You got to understand something. He loved all of humanity before he made them. It's all about love.
Amen.
That's why that banner is right there. When we get a bigger building, that banner is going to be right where it was there. People are going to walk into ministry and see God is love. Period. Because without that, your faith is it's empty. It'll have no power. It'll have no power.
Amen.
Forgive others as you have been forgiven if you want to see. People are going to see that you're a merciful person. Do you know that? See, when I say about faith that can be seen, they're going to see how you treat people. They're going to see how when you're out, somebody needs a helping hand. It isn't about things. Sometimes you just may be out somewhere and God says, hey, go buy that person lunch. Go pray for that person. That person needs a hug today. Give it to them. That's showing your faith in the love of Christ that died for you. You know that?
Amen.
That's an act of faith. Faith is a lifestyle. It's a belief in what Jesus did for you and now you're sharing it with others. It's not always about things. Your faith in God and what he has done to save your soul should be evident to all who come in contact with you. Like John said, get out in the world, man. Show people you got a passion and a fire for God, that your hope is in Christ alone. They're seeing your faith in what he did for you. They're seeing your faith in the finished work of the cross. So much teaching is, you got to have faith to have things. God's going to give me more things than I can possibly ever use. He already has. He's given me eternal life. He's given me the most awesome, beautiful, anointed woman of God for a wife. I'm kind of partial. If you haven't, it's just one of those things. After 15 and a half years, I look at her now and I love her more now than when we started. Because God has been so good to me. I did nothing to deserve that, and neither did any of you other men in here, by the way. So that being said, no, it's true. It's a gift from heaven. It's a gift. I have a gift. Somebody said, oh, who was it, Hankins? And when he was first married, he was throwing a tizzy, said something with his wife or something, he was having an attitude. He went in to pray. God says, I ain't talking to you. Go ask your wife for forgiveness. We ain't talking until you do it. And then he said, that's my girlfriend. He went out and asked for forgiveness. He said, man, make sure you know whose real boyfriend your wife walks with. I've said that before to men, and they don't like that much. She's married to Jesus. I get the blessing of her marriage to Christ, to have a godly woman. And if we saw each other that way in a marriage, boy, it would change everything in our home life. Amen? But this is your foundation for faith that can be seen. It's going to get better in a second. Hebrews 11. Mm. 1-3. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good testimony. By faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen are not made of the things which are visible. Do people see your confidence, your faith in God's word? They can't see God standing here. But did they see your faith in the one that they can't see? Can you imagine what those people were saying when Moses walked up to the Red Sea with a staff in his hand? You gonna do what? God said. They didn't see God. They couldn't focus on him. They saw a Red Sea and an Egyptian army that was about to kill them all. You got an ocean, you got an army, and you got some old guy standing there with a staff in his hand. God said, Moses, you go part the sea. Couldn't see it, heard his voice, went and did it. Is your faith evidence to those when you talk to people, when people ask me about why I believe in Jesus and I start talking about salvation and all that God's done for me and the power of the blood of Christ to wash away my sins? They're seeing my faith in what he did. Visibly, they see a difference in me. Like I said, even some of the kids I help on Thursday night, they see me now. But that's after 25 and a half years of being processed by God on potter's wheel. I said, you didn't see me then. Praise God, you didn't. You see what God has done with me now to mold me into the image of the Son. The thing is, the molding continues every day. And then tomorrow, and then Tuesday, and then Wednesday. Never allow the molding to stop. Because like I said, there's a joy running through me the more he molds me. I wish I could say molding was easy. Got quiet at your stop. It is not. Let him squeeze you. Because the only thing he's going to take out of you and offer you is what's held you back from complete freedom in Christ alone. We should be so free, our feet shouldn't even hit the ground. We should be walking so free in the spiritual realm because we're walking in love. When you walk in love and the love of Christ that he's put in you, you all have the power of his love in you. You're going to see that in a minute. We're without excuse, church. Yes. We really are, because I'm going to show you that in a minute. See, because I really thought this whole thing, faith that can be seen with the signs, wonders, and miracles. Yeah, that's part of it. That's the easy part. But what they need to see in you is your faith in what he did. And now they need to see the love of God that you've been filled with. And the reason they don't is because you got stuff inside of you, usually against yourself or against people, that hasn't been settled yet. Amen?
Amen.
You don't need to go there. Just Psalm 145, two little verses. Write it down. Verses 8 and 9. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger and great in mercy. The Lord is good to all. He doesn't just say to saved people, does he?
Amen.
It doesn't say says it rains on the just and the unjust, folks. He's good to all. He's merciful to everybody. They're made new every morning. Amen. His tender mercies are over all his works. That's the whole earth and everything in it and everybody on it. Now, he's full of what? Compassion. 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 That word's going to come up in the next couple scriptures. He's filled with compassion. Who lives in you?
Full of compassion.
Who lives in you?
Jesus.
The God that's full of compassion. What do you have in you?
Compassion.
Compassion. And the power of it. You'll see what he's doing here, because if you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you're filled with all the power of his love. You're filled with all the power of his compassion for lost people. Mm. For your brothers and sisters in Christ that are struggling, that are having a hard life right now. Life hits you very hard. Life comes at you from every direction. People get sick, people you love and care about. I'm going through that with a pastor friend of mine in town right now. And it's really hard to maintain, because God's bringing me to a place where I don't tolerate sickness. It's a reality, but I don't tolerate it. I am under the blessing. I am not under a curse. And as long as I live under a blessing, his word says he'll let no plague, no pestilence befall me. That's the way I live. That's the way I think. That's the way I speak. Now, a lot of people think I'm a little bit on the crazy side, and that's good. But that's why I feel so good at 62 and better than when I was 20, because I believe what God said, not what the world says. I listen less and less and less to what the world says and more to what God says. And it's amazing how much more peace I have in my heart now than I've ever had in my whole life.
Amen.
And it's not because of things. It's because Jesus has emptied me out more.
Amen.
I'm just saying, his Drano system works a lot better than anything you can get in the doctor's office. Amen?
Amen.
You don't need pills. You need Jesus.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Now, I say you're filled with his compassion, and people say, well, how can that be? Don't go over there. Romans 5:5. Now hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. 2 Peter 1, verse 4. We have been given the divine nature of God. 1 John 2:6. We ought to walk just as he walked. You've been filled with his divine nature, which is centered in love and filled with compassion. You already have it. You already have the power of his love to heal and set and save every captive free. Everybody, it's in you already. It's in you. Everybody in here has got the Holy Ghost. And if you don't, you need to take a deep breath and let it fill you up, because it's in this house. It's in this house. God's in the house, amen?
Amen.
God's in the house, amen?
Amen?
God's in the house. See, the Bible says you're already filled with God and the fullness of him. The fullness of the Godhead dwelt in bodily form in Christ, and Christ is in you and you're in him. You already have his compassion in there. The reason we don't share his love and compassion, we're afraid people are going to hurt us. Well, join the rest of us. We can't live in a bubble. If you're afraid to go out and love, then you need to stay home. I'll be honest with you, it's as simple as you won't be able to serve God if you don't walk in love and you're afraid to love. It is scary sometimes, because we've all been hurt, and everybody in here has. I am no different, and neither are you. But that's why we go back to Jesus and let him heal that wound, that whatever hurt us, and say, Lord, here, I'm carrying this, and it's not my job to carry pain. You broke the power of pain to take me down. You went to the cross for that. Your love brings healing and wholeness back to my heart and soul, amen?
Amen.
That's why it talks about the healing and the restoration of the soul so much. David talked about it quite a bit. But he came to make you whole again, heart, soul, mind, and body. And we can't be afraid to go out and love people again. Are people still going to say things to hurt you and offend you and everything else? Let it slide off, like when you put oil on a pan and you got something cooking, it slides right out, doesn't it? That should be you, because you're filled with new oil and new wine from heaven. And the stuff that comes on you should slide off and go right to Jesus where they belong, not you. If you let it stick to you, then you've taken offense by people that are just being human. Humans do human stuff. I checked this morning. We're still human. Is more of God in me than ever before? Yeah. But Like I said, the day I get there, he's probably taking me home. Because it's a constant journey on our way to heaven. Enjoy the ride. But don't let anybody steal your love affair with Jesus.
Amen.
Don't let anything touch that. That's yours. Every one of you should have a love affair with Jesus, and you should never let anybody touch it, nor defile it, nor put their hands on it. Mm. Oh, in Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord.
That's between you and Him. Mm-hmm. That's what will keep you walking in His love. Because
yes.
You're going to see when you've been hurt and offended and wounded, it hurt Him more.
Yes.
Because you're made in His image and His likeness. He went here so He could take all the offenses that come on you and break their power to hurt you and to keep you in pain and suffering.
Yes.
He did it. He said, all the offenses that fall on you fall on me. Mm. See, so let them slide off you onto the one that has the power to break any damage it did to your heart and soul. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, thank you, Jesus. If you have your Bibles, turn to Mark, first chapter. You're going to see the desire of God's compassion for people. Mark 1st chapter, verses 40 and 41. Oh, thank you, Jesus. And you'll stay there because we're going right into Mark 2 after that. We're going to have to turn too many pages today. In Mark the 1st chapter, verses 40 to 41, now a leper came to Him, imploring Him, kneeling down to Him, saying to Him, if You are willing, You can make me clean. Then Jesus moved with compassion. He got moved by it. Are you moved by the power of God's compassion in you to touch people? And stretched out His hand and touched him and said, I am willing, be cleansed. You know, you don't have to implore God anymore. You don't have to beg God for anything. Jesus took all that imploring stuff down. Humble yourself and receive. When you go to God, expect Him to answer your prayers.
Yes.
He says, call upon My name. I'll answer, honor, rescue, and deliver you. I'll satisfy you with long life and let you behold My salvation. People ask me how I expect to have a satisfied long life. The book says so. God didn't write it just for me to look at it and read it. He wrote the Bible by the Holy Spirit so I believe it. So it adds years to my life like the Word said. So His Word will be health to my flesh and strength to my bones. When God says, I'm going to satisfy you with a long life, it's finished. Three words, it is finished. When He said, I'm going to satisfy you with a long life, Moses had perfect eyesight when he went home. My eyes have actually gotten better, not worse. I used to have a lot stronger reading glasses. Now it's working its way backwards. I was hoping it would happen immediately, but it hasn't. But that's okay, too. I even told him, I said, it doesn't matter. Even with the glasses, it's just fine. I can be just fine. But I said, you know what? You said you were going to restore all the years, so I'm holding you at your word. Do you know you can hold God to His word?
Amen.
If you're obedient. Don't leave here on Sunday and go out and raise all kinds of cane in town and think He's going to bless you for it, okay? Your requirement is to choose godliness and holiness and righteousness and virtue and all that is good and kind and the fruits of the Spirit. That's a person that walks in love. You know, the fruits of the Spirit, if people see that in you, you're walking in faith and they're going to see your faith. Because the fruit of the Spirit comes by your faith in Him. Your faith in Him brought the Holy Spirit to live in you. All the gifts of the Holy Spirit are in you. All the fruits of the Spirit are in you. The compassion of God is in you. The love of God is in you. Why aren't people seeing it? How come it got quiet? We're not healed yet, folks. Let Him heal you today.
Amen.
Whatever you've been looking back on, whatever's been holding you back, you kick it to the curb. Whatever wound you got to your heart and soul, you give it to the cross right now. So the fullness of God's love. He was moved. Movement means He was moved with compassion. In compassion, He wanted this man healed. And you didn't touch lepers in them days because then you were an unclean vessel. Nothing can make Jesus unclean, amen?
Amen.
It can't touch Him. Sin can't touch Him. I tell people all the time, well, I'll be okay. I'll believe in Jesus. No, you're living in sin. That means you don't believe in Jesus. And guess what? I checked the last time I was in heaven, there was no sin there. So if you're in a sinful lifestyle, that means you don't have a new divine nature yet. Do we get it perfect every day? No. Every one of you has slipped here or there. You're falling short of the mark. That's what sin means, falling short of the mark. But we have an advocate for us. His name is Jesus. He said your sins were forgiven past, present, and future. Make sure you humble yourself. Don't go pleading with God. Don't go begging God. That's an insult. Do you know that? See, people are begging God to help me. What are you begging him for? Or you say, Jesus, you said you would deliver me from all evil. You would guard my going out and coming in. You would forgive all my sins and heal all my diseases. You would provide all that I need. Why are you begging him for something that he's already given you?
Amen.
He said, I've come, I've given you an abundant life. Why don't you live it? He said, I've come to bless you and to restore all the years that were taken for you. Why don't you live it? Receive it. Don't beg him for it. Don't ask. It's already done. Thank him that the blessings of Abraham are upon your life. Thank him that you're fresh and flourishing.
Hallelujah.
Thank him that you have the mind of Christ, that your thoughts are no longer yours but his.
Hallelujah.
You have the mind of Christ in you and all that he thinks and does. Let him show you how he thinks upon you.
Amen.
Oh man, you'll see yourself different. Let me tell you something. If he can change the way I think about myself, there's hope for everybody. You're a piece of cake. Amen. Into Mark, the second chapter, verses 1 to 5. The evidence of our faith. It's amazing how much he did and how many people just still didn't believe in him. Because he didn't come as people thought. I had people tell me, I remember when I was a young Christian walking the streets in West LA in the middle of a gang war. Boy, you don't look like no minister. My response was, what do they look like? I asked these gangsters, what would they look like? What do they look like? They used to a guy on Sunday morning like God's got me dressed now with a tie and stuff on. I said, no, you don't see those guys when they're out and we're doing evangelism. They go, what do you mean? I said, because they dress just like me. They got a shirt on, they got shorts on, they got whatever on, they got shoes on. But the shirt and tie and the coat, that's usually for Sunday morning. If they're walking around the street in the summertime with a shirt and a coat and a tie on, we need to pray for them because they ain't got much wisdom, all right? Just saying. But I said, they looked at it and I said, what does a man of God look like? And I went home and I said, what does that mean? He said, people have such a preconceived idea that ministers are in this little wooden box and they're supposed to walk a certain way, talk a certain... Don't ever lose who you are. Don't lose your personality. You're all uniquely different and awesome in the eyes of God. Don't lose who you are as individuals. I've said this before, it's really on me now. God's going to change you to where there's nothing left of you but Him. But you're not going to lose who you are. Your personality, He gave it to you for a reason. You smile a certain way. You talk a certain way. You have certain characteristics that somebody else might not have. And you're going to reach people that the one next to you can't. Be who He made you to be, not like someone else. The only role model, the only example we got, the only one we're supposed to look like, talk like, walk like, and act like is Jesus.
Amen.
That's it. That's it. Everybody's so afraid of losing who you are, you're just going to lose the junk that messes up your journey with Jesus. That's all you're going to lose. He's just going to burn out the roots He didn't plant. Let him burn you up today in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
Let's see about the evidence of our faith. And again, he entered Capernaum, and after some days, it was heard that he was in the house. I love that. When you go somewhere, people should go, oh. They should know you're there. The evidence of your faith should be evident. Your compassion, your love for people, your mercy towards people. Your caring of the lost, the brokenhearted, and the wounded. Immediately many gathered together so that there was no longer room to receive them, not even at the door. Like John had that vision dream last night. When you go somewhere, heads should turn. No matter where, I don't care if it's the grocery store, the gas station, or anywhere else. Now we've been here 5.5 years, every Sunday morning I go next door and I get something to drink for my wife and I or something, bring a bottle of water, whatever we want. They all turn around. Morning, Pastor. I'm not into the pastor title name thing, but they know who we are because I go in there and I pray with them. And they ask for prayers for people that are sick in their family and stuff, so we do. You see, because they know about my faith in God. I wear my faith right here. I tell people I believe everything in the book. I believe God's going to do everything He said He's going to do. So is it not by my action, but by how I talk and how I treat them in there? See, that's for all of you. They're going to see your faith in Christ by how you speak and talk and walk. Are you walking like it said back in John, back in there? What chapter is that? 1 John 2:6. If you say you know God and you love God, you should walk just as He walked. Why don't you? Because He's living in you. Or you got your shoes on and not His. Ooh. Yeah, just human. Yeah, sometimes. Yeah, me though. God bless you. And He preached what? The Word to them. Then they came to Him bringing a paralytic who was carried by four men. And when they could not come near Him because of the crowd, they uncovered the roof where He was. So when they had broken through, they let down the bed on which the paralytic was lying. And when Jesus saw their faith, not by what they said, but by their actions, He said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven you." The actions before Jesus, those He saw their faith because of their actions. People should see your faith because of your actions, the way you live. They should see your faith in Christ by how you live, how you talk, how you walk. They see your faith in God. That's why they're trying to get you into all the other stuff. Come join us in our darkness, like the Bible says. Read the first proverb. It talks about people pulling you in. Come be with us. Let's lie and wait for innocent blood. All that good stuff. Because that's what that is, gossip, by the way. Innocent blood on people. So know that you know that you know. They're going to see your faith. Jesus didn't say because anything they said, it was because of what they did. They had such faith in the healer, they knew He was healing. He came to a house, they started going and grabbing the sick. That should be in every ministry in the country in Jesus' name.
Amen.
He has never stopped healing, nor performing signs, wonders, and miracles, nor will He until it's over. In that love chapter where it says tongues and everything else be done away with, when that which is perfect has come. When you meet Jesus, you don't have any gifts of the Spirit in heaven. I checked, I was there. You don't need it. Because you have on a glorified body. You talk about unspeakable joy. Oh, Jesus. He saw their faith. Can God see yours? Get awful quiet in here today. It's because you haven't allowed the power of His love to totally heal your soul and your heart. See, because we have His compassion inside of us. We have His love in us. We've been sealed eternally with the Holy Spirit. It's not like we have to go looking for something. It's not something you can do to go make it happen. It was put into you to be used for His glory. See, everything that's inside of you, if it's not of God, then it needs to be taken out of you. Amen?
Amen.
If you got stuff in your heart you're desiring so bad above your journey with Jesus, it needs to go away. You need to put it in the grave and leave it there. It's not of God. I've told Him a long time ago, and He actually told me, He says, you have to let Me take the stuff out of your heart that you want, and be replaced with the stuff that I desired for you before the world began. You talk about surgery in your heart muscle? Oh, buddy, do things change. Because now all of a sudden all your desires, you find out probably about 90% of them didn't come from heaven. God's never going to lead you in the ways of the flesh, but in the ways of the Spirit. So if it's things you want, then you haven't given Him permission to purify your heart. And you won't walk in the power of His love and compassion. When He shows me that compassion moved Him, and His compassion, I want you all healed and whole. Everybody. Even a leper, who when you touched a leper, back in those days under the law, you were an unclean vessel. You had to go through the whole cleaning process again. I checked this morning, he's still holy and perfect. He's never been unclean. He's never been unclean, nor will he be. He can't lie. He can't be unclean. He can't be unholy. He can't be anything even human. He came as a human to break the power of a human nature to take you under so you can be raised in a new life. You're a new creation right now. You're no longer a sinner because He's made you. You are filled with His love and compassion. You need to give it permission to live through you and be manifested through you. 2 Corinthians 4th chapter. Carry around the death of Christ in your mortal body, your human side, so that the life of Christ can be manifested in your mortal flesh. That's His compassion coming out. Do you have compassion today to walk through the stores and lay hands on the sick? Do you have compassion for lost souls when you leave here today, when God puts somebody in your path that's a purebred heathen, cussing, dirty, ungodly person, and say, I have compassion on this soul to be saved? Is that your heart when you, because in here it's easy. Loving each other in here is easy. We're all born again believers, potluck every Sunday, every once a month, and it's turning into every Friday night. We know how to eat in this house, amen? But the thing is, though, think about what I'm saying. In here, it's easy to love one another, isn't it? We're all here because of Jesus. We're all saved. We're all sanctified. We're all sealed with the Spirit. We've all been washed in the blood of Jesus. But when you leave here now, the compassion we have for one another here, do you take that out there? Or do you leave it in here and in your house? And then between the two points, that's where it stays. He showed me my church is afraid to love again. God's heart is broken because we're not allowing Him to restore us so we can go back to being a church founded on the power of His love. The power of it. We can't be afraid to love people. I've been through it. There were years in my walk with Christ where I said, I ain't going out loving nobody no more. Then He brought me a wife. That changed that. He knew how to soften my heart, amen? So just saying. But think about what God showed me this week. He said, my church, not everybody, but He said a lot of the body of Christ is still the walking wounded. There's still the walking wounded. We haven't let Him heal our broken hearts. I've come to heal the brokenhearted and set my captives free and open up that prison you've been living in so you can walk in the newness of life, driven by compassion to see everybody saved and every captive set free. And your compassion of Christ in you should desire that. People should see that you have God's compassion for the lost and the brokenhearted and the wounded. Who? You want to see miracles? Have God's compassion touch lives. When they see that in you, they'll be running down this street to get in those doors. Because they know God's compassion and love is what motivates us to see everybody saved and healed and set free and restored to wholeness in Christ Jesus. That's why the church was formed, to take the power of that kingdom out into all the earth. Amen? Oh, hallelujah. Ooh, you need to let God touch you today. 1 Corinthians, 2nd chapter. We're just about there. This is another subject that I had to stop what I was doing yesterday afternoon. There was just too much there about God's love. You know, if we just spent our days witnessing to people how much they love, I guarantee you'd see lives changed. Because they would see that you actually care. Do we really care about the lost and the broken? Do we?
Oh, Jesus.
Because God cared about you because you were lost and broken. You were destitute, on your way to eternal darkness. 2 Corinthians 2, 1 through 5. And I, brethren, when I came to you, did not come with excellence of speech or of wisdom declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I was with you in weakness and fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power. That your faith should not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. A man of God that had, he could have boasted. He, imagine what he could have said to them, as smart as he was. Wouldn't know 4 or 5 languages. I don't know exactly. I should look that up sometime and find out. But he was more advanced than his teachers of his day. He was above them. He knew more. He could have come in there and gave dissertations of the theology of the gospel of Jesus like nobody else on the earth. But he came and preached Jesus Christ and Him crucified. He didn't make the gospel difficult. He made it simple. See, your salvation message out here, don't make a lot of words. Make something that people can understand. They're going to see your faith in what Christ has done for you to save you. Don't make a big, long dissertation of what salvation is. They don't need that. They need to know where your hope is, where your faith is set, where your eyes are focused on. And when they see that in you, They should be seeing the compassion you have for their wounds and their hurts and their lostness. That's when they're going to be drawn to you, and that's where you're going to minister to them. It's so important that you want to see the demonstration of the Spirit. Like I said, faith, we started out with faith works by what?
Love.
See, if you go out there and give people a whole long dissertation on the message of salvation, you will lose them about 2 minutes in. People don't want complications. The reason why we got a whole entire lost generation from probably the age 50 down in this country is because they're living in la-la land. They go to doctors every day for medicine to change their mood. So it's disgusting. You go to the doctor, well, I'm not feeling good here, this will change your mood. Never go. If you have an emotional issue, you go to your mighty counselor first.
Amen.
He's the mighty counselor, he's the Prince of Peace. When I was a young Christian, I was a little wild, I had people tell me maybe I should go get some counseling for some of my issues. I went home and I prayed because I was a wild young Christian. I had real mentors that took their sword and they poked me from all sides. Amen. You know where I went? To my knees. You know who helped me with the issues of my emotions and everything? My counselor, my healer, my savior, my comforter, my God who loves me more than life itself, who died for me. I go to the Prince of Peace, the mighty counselor, because I did have some issues because I was so changed. I really didn't know who I was for a while. I had all this Holy Ghost coming out of me and I didn't know what to do with it. I was so different. I started thinking, well, maybe I do got some issues here. Maybe I should go talk to a Christian counselor. I went home and got on my knees the one night because I was really troubled. Because more than once a second and a third person says something, maybe you should start to listen. I wasn't very good at listening back then. Just saying. Don't say a word. She's smiling back there. But guess what? I got on my knees. He said, what does that say? You're my mighty counselor. You're my Prince of Peace. He says, I'm the only counselor you're ever going to need. I'm the only wisdom you're ever going to need. I'm the only savior you're ever going to need. I'm the only healer you're ever gonna need. I'm your provider. I am everything that life is and more. I want it. It settled it right then. The next time I was out and somebody said something, I said, I went to go see my counselor. So don't bother me anymore. And it was free too. He didn't charge me a thing. Ooh, they wondered who my counselor was. After a while, they realized. Because I didn't have to say it anymore. They watched him work and change me day by day by day as I started to mature a little bit and a little bit and a little bit. That maturity thing in Christ is rough to handle, amen?
Amen.
You won't see the Spirit of power living through you unless you walk in the power of His love first. How many Christians get born again, they get the Holy Ghost, God does some stuff through them, then they're so focused on the gifts of the Spirit instead of on the love of Christ. Everybody wants to operate in all these gifts. First of all, there isn't a gift of the Holy Spirit that He won't operate through any one of you at any specific time. If you look for other people that are working in the giftings, then you're looking at people, not in the gift that lives within you. The Holy Spirit operates the gifts through us. We don't operate the gifts. The gifts operate through us by the Holy Spirit, the fullness of God in you. People got that whole teaching wrong. When people ask you what gifts you operate in, say yes.
Yes.
And they're going to do like they did to me. You're crazy. Thank you, Jesus. The Holy Spirit is all things to all people, not Paul. Paul was not all things to all people. The Holy Spirit in him was. God says, I know what's in all people. I don't ask anybody any questions. Friday night he said, here some of you are asking too many questions. He reminded me of that last night as I asked him. What did you say to everybody Friday night? What did I say through you? Stop with the questions. Whoops. I spoke it Friday night, but last night I was asking him the same question again. Guilty. God loves us. Amen.
Amen.
We're human, folks. Don't go there. 1 Corinthians 4:20. For the kingdom of God is not in word, but in power. 1 Thessalonians 1. Verse 5, for our gospel did not come to you in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and in much assurance, as you know what kind of men we were among you for your sake. Do people know that you're people of faith? Is there evidence of it? Do they see it? By your speech, do people know that you're a person of faith in Jesus Christ? Yeah. Do they know you're a person of love? Do they know you're a person of compassion and mercy and understanding? That's why I said his compassions fail not. His mercies are made new every what?
Morning.
When you get drained of, he'll put back in. But don't get to a place where he's got you all filled up and you keep it to yourself. Because we do. It's safe there.
Yes.
There's no pain there. When I was in my little apartment with just Jesus, me, and the dog in West LA, I liked it there. There were days I didn't want to go out of the apartment. He says, you're here studying and praying all day? Now get up and go walk the dog. There's somebody that needs me. They don't need you. They need him. But he's sending you to bring him and his love and compassion to them. You are temples of the Most High God. You are a sanctuary where God's come to take up residence. You're not allowed to live in there anymore. Just saying. What's getting awful quiet today? Believe me, when I started out studying this whole faith that can be seen thing this week, I actually thought it was going to be a whole different message. I really did. And then he said, it's all about my love, Dennis. There's nothing else that's going to change this world. And unless my church goes back to loving people again, having my compassion for people again, people aren't going to get saved and healed. I do it through my church. I'm at the right hand of the Father, but the fullness of my Father and me and the Holy Spirit, the fullness of the Godhead is in you. All my divine nature is in you. All my characteristics and all my glory is in you. And unless the church gets a mission statement again in their heart of my love and compassion for this world that's out here, starts judging the world and starts loving the world again that I made in my image and my likeness for my purposes, then these people are not going to hear how much they love. They're going to hear, oh, you're Christians, you hate us because we're doing this. You better not hate because you're not allowed to. Hate sin. But don't ever hate the sinner. Even these people in these streets that are doing what they're doing, half of them are getting paid to do it. Because they got no hope because they don't have Jesus. They don't have Jesus because they don't see love and compassion through the body of Christ any longer. We're too busy pointing fingers than we are. It's easy to point fingers. I walk through the stores, I see the demons that are on people. But I don't start pointing fingers at them. I don't know how they got there. But my job is to be available if they want help getting out of darkness. Unless they see the light of God's love inside of you, why would they even come to a ministry? Why would they want to be a part of what we follow and what we believe if they don't see the fullness of God's love and compassion in us? This is as serious as it gets today. We have a lost world out there. I watched it on the news this weekend. I sat and I cried. My heart was broken. I said, Lord, how could people be so far gone? They don't even have a conscience anymore. At least when I was a heathen, I had a conscience. I knew I was evil. It wasn't a mystery, okay? Because I had a conscience, but people's consciences have been made dead for the last 40 years, 50 years. There's a deadness in them. There's no light of hope nor truth in these kids anymore. And it was so sad to see that we've allowed our country to take these children this far into darkness. But guess what? There's a new day arising. That moon that's going to be the biggest moon ever since Israel was established, by the way. It starts tonight up until tomorrow morning. Guess what? Yeah, when I saw that it was the last time that happened was Israel was established, we now have a president in the White House, then guess what? He's friends with Israel.
Amen.
He's friends with Israel. He's friends with Israel. God put that man in the White House. Because he's bold enough to say, I stand with you. We will stand together.
Amen.
We will stand with my children Israel. Oh, hallelujah. There's a new dawn arising. That moon's just another sign. You better get ready because there's a big God on the move.
Amen.
Like I said, when we get a new building, we're going to have 10-foot letters. I'm going to put them on the wall outside. Jesus is Lord, now pray bigger. And now I'm going to put a sign on the ministry that says outside, we are one with his children Israel. Read Ephesians 2:14-18. It shows you how much we're one with Israel. The whole body of Christ was made to be one with Israel from the day he died and rose again. Man put a wedge down the middle. God's going to take that wedge out so we're united back to Israel the way we're supposed to be as a nation and as a people. Amen?
Amen.
Now I know this is the point you probably expected earlier in the teaching. We're going to close with John 14. 12 to 14. There's a new church coming. I'm burning up. There's a new church coming. Oh, hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
There's a new church coming.
Amen.
There is a new church that's going to be refined with fire. It's going to be purged of the world. And it's going to walk and talk and love and behave and have compassion just the way Jesus did. Just the way Jesus did. Amen?
Amen.
Man, when people start feeling that they're loved and not judged, when they see that you got a heart of compassion and you're moved by the compassion that God put in you to reach people, they're going to be drawn like John had that dream vision this morning. What a powerful thing, because people saw that years ago. The devil's done everything he can to hinder what God's doing, but you know what? He didn't hinder anything. He just gave me more resolve that what God's doing is only something God can do and we can't. We're just a fellow laborer of the work of the Holy Spirit. Remember
Amen.
That.
Amen.
But perseverance brings it all together.
Yes.
Steadfast in the Lord today, folks. Oh, thank you, Jesus.
John 14,
just 12 and 14. Most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. Whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Now, what have I said about things? People turn that into things. Are you asking God for people to be healed? For people to be saved? To be whole? Are you asking the Father, use us to save every soul in this city in Jesus'
Amen.
Name? That's the right kind of prayer. That's the right kind of prayer. But if you take that verse and you start going to God and you start saying, well, you know what, I need this, I need, and you turn it into a wish list, you'll not. Nobody's going to get answers to that stuff anymore. You better be careful, because the devil can bring you possessions. Be careful what you ask for. The devil can bring you possessions, because if that's what you lust for, that's what you will receive. You reap what you sow. If you reap to the flesh, fleshly things is what you'll desire. He wants you to have a blessed, prosperous life. There's not a thing wrong with it. People say, man, they got nice cars, they got nice homes. So? And? God said, I'm going to give you the abundant life. But if that's your desires, this prayer will turn into a prayer. Those scriptures, so many Christians use for possessions. Someday I'm going to go around the world in a Learjet. I'm not going to pay a dime for it. Because he told me in the Word, you're not going to pay for this. The Learjets are mine. And if I need you to get from here to another country, I'll transport you if I have to with my spirit. He did it for Philip. Why won't he do it for us? I'm just saying. If you need to be in the north end of town here in 3 minutes because you need to pray for somebody, I can't drive that fast. No, but God's Spirit's already there. He can transport you. Like I said, people think I'm a little crazy when I say things like that, and I like it. Because I got a God that's so above human thinking.
Amen.
He's so far above our thinking and our ways, it's awesome.
Amen.
You should expect God, but when I pray in the name of Jesus for somebody to be blessed, for somebody to be healed, for somebody to be taken care of, for their needs to be met, that's the right kind of prayers. Now, I do believe that God's going to give me the prosperous, abundant life. And as far as I'm concerned, I already have it. So my focus isn't there. When I pray, Father, in Jesus' name, I pray this whole city be saved. That's a godly prayer. Pray and believe it, and it will be done, he says. When two or more are gathered in my name, I'm there in their midst. What you pray and believe in, I will do it. Decree and declare a thing, and I will establish it. Do it. See, start changing your prayer life. Then when the blessings of finances and things and possessions come, they're still not going to be that important to you. They're nice to have, don't get me wrong. I believe in the abundant life. I believe in new vehicles. I believe in nice homes. I believe in all that. But it's not my focus of attention. When I pray these prayers, I pray for the salvation of every human being, and so should we be. And we bless you. We should be praying that in the name of Jesus. Give God something to do that he really wants to do. But he wants to do it through all of us. You have to stop looking this way. You have to start looking this way. Christ is sending me out to bring the life of salvation to people, the love of God to people, the compassion of God to people. Stop waiting for Him to do something. He already did it. And not only that, He put all that He wants to do for humanity inside of you. Oh. Oh. Yeah, come on. Come on, wake up. He put all He wants to do for humanity inside of every one of His children. And we're waiting around for God to do something when He already died, He already rose again. He is filled with compassion. If you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you're filled with His compassion. Why isn't it coming out of you? Why aren't people seeing faith that can be seen? Faith is how you live and your actions how you live.
Amen.
And how you treat your fellow man. This whole election thing, one thing it revolved around a lot of people jumping up and down. They're so happy somebody so evil got destroyed. No, she didn't. She's a lost soul. And she's about to meet her maker. And if she don't get saved soon, she's going to spend eternity with her father, the devil. And half the other politicians. They do not know the Lord. They go to a church building all they want. Like I said, I'm going to go pull. Her car is sitting in the garage. And you know when we get home, it's still going to be a Hyundai. She may be a little disappointed, but she's not going to go home. There's not going to be a Bentley in there, okay? It's still going to be a Hyundai when we get home. You can go to a building all you want. God has made you a son and a daughter of the Most High God. God has made you a priest and a king. God has made you victorious. God has saved your soul. God has done. Now go out and God will do through you the day you give Him permission.
Amen.
Once you realize your life is not about you, but about the King Jesus that's coming so quickly. Like I said, He told me there's not near as much time as a lot of people think there is on this planet. He doesn't do anything without not telling His prophets first, and I'm not the only one that's gotten that. Other people, there's an anxiousness in the spirit. You can see it. A lot more ministers are going back. Get right with Jesus now. Get saved now. Get the Holy Ghost now. You need His power. Don't be a carnal Christian. Be a supernatural. You were created to be a supernatural people.
Amen.
Signs, wonders, and miracles are to follow you, and He will perform them in you and through you so that they see that you got God inside of you. It's time for us to change as a church, folks. Amen?
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I'm really glad because I don't think we're going to use the heat as much this winter. He told me there's a fire brewing. Ooh. Ha. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego.
Amen.
That's what the church is to look like. Think about what God just showed me. Fire. Hebrews says what? Our God is a
consuming
fire. Amen. Wow. God is weeping right now. There's so many more souls. The world has left Him no choice but to pull back. Fathers, we come before You this day. Forgive me, Lord, for not being more loving and more merciful and more compassionate. God, we were created to walk in the power of Your love, to seek and to save those that are lost. God, teach me and teach your church to have your compassion and to be moved by it, to reach every soul that you bring to us, to walk in the power of your love. Because when we walk in your love, you will perform signs, wonders, and miracles. You will confirm that we're walking in love by it, the performance of your word, living through us, touching us. The blind will see, the lame will walk, the deaf will hear, the dead will be raised. But that's only done through us, by your love, by your power, the Holy Spirit's power that is in us. Lord, teach us to be moved by your compassion. Take out of our hearts anything that's not of you that holds us back. Take out any fear that we have from not loving the way you love, oh God. If we truly love you and walk with you and want to do your will, we will truly and freely love, unconditionally, just the way you loved us before we surrendered to you and you saved us. You delivered us from darkness to walk in light, oh God. God, have mercy. Have mercy on myself and on your whole church. Lord, help us to turn from the ways of the world, to turn back to the ways of God, those things that are eternal. Give us a heart and mind that focuses on sharing you with everyone we come in contact with, Lord Jesus. Because there isn't a person on this earth that is insavable, that is irredeemable, that you can't fix and mend and make whole again. That's how powerful thy great love is, oh God. So Father, I come before you and I surrender all that I am into your hands. And whatever changes need to be made in me, let it start with me. I love you, I worship you, I adore you. And I pray a blessing upon everybody in here right now, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus, and make the church just the way you are. Oh God, Jesus, you walk so humbly before the Father. Let the church walk so humbly before you again. And let us worship you with awe and reverence and magnifying your holy name in all that we say or do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Come walk in Jesus. Now be merciful, humble.
Father, I lift your son John up to you in the holy and the mighty name of Jesus. His heart is a heart steered towards you and doing your will. Show him, Lord, that there's nothing behind him, that everything's in front of him. And what's ever tried to hold him back from walking in the power of that love, he's so kind, he's so caring. Him and Linda, they help so many people. But Lord, I just thank you for unity in their marriage and their business, that even their business that you've blessed them with, it just be filled with your Holy Spirit of salvation. All the people that work under them, Lord, will all be born again, Spirit-filled believers. And as they go into homes, it's not just there to fix their air conditioning and heating. It's there to bring the love and the compassion of Jesus Christ. And I thank you, whatever healing needs to happen in John right now, you're purifying anything that's affected his heart so that he walk in the power of thy love and compassion every step that he takes. Because, Lord, that is his heart's desire, is to worship you and serve you and do your will. And, Lord, you say when we come before you and we surrender and we confess, you will answer our prayers. Oh, Lord, we just want to walk in your love and compassion from this moment forward. And I thank you that we're being transformed this day into that complete whole oneness with you, Father, in the name of Jesus. I don't know what changes he's going to make in your life, but something's about to change. I don't know what that is. He just said this change is coming. Just let him happen. He's going to free you and bring you up more so you can walk with him more, because that's your heart. I know it is, and so does he. And today he just said this change is coming. And when they change, you're not going to do them? Yeah, you're not going to do them? He's going to do them because today he gave permission for it. Wow. It's going to be awesome. Oh, man.
I love you, Jesus.
Amen. Some of you today have to forgive yourselves. I don't know what you're holding against yourself, but you're not a judge. You're forgiven. Everything in your life's washed away in the blood. Forgive yourself. Jesus is perfect. You're in the perfection process. We have a perfect God in us, amen? You don't have the right to hold something against yourself because God does not. He's never held anything against us. That's how much He loves us. He's a God like, there's nothing else to compare Him to. He is so uniquely different. His love is so pure, it's so holy, it's so unconditional, it's undefiled. It's perfect in all its motives towards us. That's the God we belong to today. So if you got something against yourself today, and God's showing it to you right now, you bow your head and say, Jesus, here, I give that to you. So you can be healed and whole in heart, mind, body, and soul. Amen? Amen.